Consider this extension, Q rejoined root 3 and root 5 of Q. So we got the base field being the rationals, this the smallest subfield of the reals containing all the rationals, also containing root 3, also containing root 5. It is a degree 4 extension. 1 square root of 3, square root of 5, and square root of 3 times square root of 5 do form a basis to make this a degree 4 extension, a four-dimensional vector space over the rationals. Any automorphisms of this are completely determined by that. That's because of two things. Again, if you apply phi to an expression like this being doubly operation preserving, you'll be able to say it's phi of a plus phi of b times phi of root 3 plus phi of c times phi of root 5 plus phi of d times phi of 3 times phi of root 5. And based on the fact that it's got a fixed q. Phi of A has to be A, phi of B has to be B, phi of C has to be C, phi of D has to be D. So if you know these values, you're going to know all possibilities. The author claims there's four automorphisms. By thinking about what the possibilities are for these things, root 3 and root 5, either map root 3 to itself and root 5 to itself, that's epsilon. Map root 3 to its opposite and root 5 to itself, that call that alpha. Switch around the roles of root 3 and root 5, what they get mapped to in terms of the minus signs, or map both of them to their opposites, which does happen to be alpha composed beta. Root 3 can't get mapped to root 5, and root 5 can't get mapped to root 3. Why? Such an automorphism would have to permute roots of x squared minus 3 equals 0 and roots of x squared minus 5 equals 0. I'm saying x, but writing omega, because I'm imagining omega to be a root of this equation when I think about that equation and this equation when I think about this one. Phi has to permute roots of the individual equations. So a root of this equation has to get permuted to another root of this equation. Same with this equation. So you've got to have this kind of mapping going on, not root 3 getting mapped to root 5, root 5 getting mapped to root 3. So these are the only four possibilities. None of these elements has order 4. This is not a cyclic group of order 4. It's isomorphic to the external direct product of Z2 with itself. It is the splitting field, it turns out, for a certain polynomial over Q. What polynomial would that be? It'd be x squared minus 3 times x squared minus 5. X to the fourth minus 8x squared plus 15. This is not irreducible over the rationals because you can factor it like that. But this is a splitting field for it over the rationals. This equals x minus root 3 times x plus root 3 times x minus root 5 times x plus root 5. It completely splits in this field, and that would be the smallest subfield of the real numbers in which it splits. This would be a splitting field. So the fundamental theorem of Galois theory would apply. Let's end class by looking at the lattices. So there's your subgroup lattice of the Galois group. Different than the one for a cyclic group, isn't it? The cyclic group example had a subgroup lattice that looked like that. Z4, cyclic group of order 4, has a unique subgroup of order 2. Z2, external direct product of Z2 is not cyclic. It's got three subgroups of order 2. And index 2 in the entire group. It also has the trivial subgroup. Fundamental theorem of Galois theory gives a correspondence between this subgroup lattice and this subfield lattice or tower of fields. The fixed field of this entire thing would be Q. What's the fixed field of epsilon alpha? I guess we got to look at what alpha does. Alpha fixes square root of 5, doesn't fix square root of 3. The fixed field of that is that. Beta fixes square root of 3. The fixed field of that is that. Alpha composed beta, it turns out, fixes not square root of 3 and square root of 5 individually, but their product. And the fixed field of epsilon is the entire field extension. And these are degree 2, just like these are indices 2. What's the practical application of all this? Well, for Galois, I was proving quintics are unsolvable, which is discussed in the reading. I'm not going to test you on it. Solvability of polynomials by radicals based on a certain definition, which I won't go into. Something called a solvable group, which I won't go into. A theorem with a big long proof that evidently culminates in the insolvability of a quintic. Not a general quintic, but a particular quintic. This one. Yeah, you don't have to study those unless you really, really want to. Maybe you want to do it for your senior seminar project. But that's the application of all this, ultimately, including thinking about these lattice diagrams. For our purposes, are there any applications? Well, it depends on what you mean by the word application. You could argue that one application comes up in example 5, which we're not going to take the time to consider today. And that application is to ultimately figuring out the lattice diagram for this over that. It helps you figure out lattice diagrams for subfield lattices, field extensions of Q. Figuring out the subfield lattice, the tower of fields for a certain field extension like this is hard without Galois theory. Without this fundamental theorem of Galois groups that I just keep hinting at without showing you the statement, because the statement's really hard. This correspondence between the diagrams is effectively what we're talking about. It helps you, because if you can figure out the subgroups of the Galois group, then you can figure out the lattice diagram for the fields, because you can think about the fixed fields. That's the point for us. Let's try to hit more home on Friday.